issues of social planning. And we also had a lot of easy hopes about how wonderful the world would be when imperialism was defeated and India was made free and the third world came to birth. And by now we see that the third world, instead of being an inspiration, is the damnedest mess on the planet. It's full of fat dictatorial bastards that mistreat their own people a hell of a lot worse than the imperialist ever dared to do. Crooks and grafters. And the great generation of idealists and reformers who spoke for Africa and Latin America got brushed aside by a whole new race, with some honorable exceptions like Fidel Castro, a whole new race of stupid military dictators that are hardly a model. And India is hardly a model. So we don't know where to turn. The intellectuals don't have any easy answers, and the government doesn't have any easy answers, and it's very hard to muster a majority for almost anything. And one of the difficulties is that we face three dangerous obsolescences. One is a kind of what you could call, for the sake of sensationalism and drama, it's overstated, of course, a kind of obsolete economic system. What I mean by that is this, that I think the basic thing wrong with our economic system is it's geared to produce more and more non-necessities or junk for those that already have everything. People that talk about new priorities tend to focus on the Pentagon, and God knows the war machine wastes billions that we could use at home. But the real need for new priorities is to try to shift a major part of our productive resources from private unnecessary luxuries and junk to public needs and the ending of public squalor. But not only our economy, but the whole world is so geared to providing more nonsense, unnecessary stuff for the middle class, that if we weren't started to act sensibly, the third world and the poorer countries would really sink into despondency and terrible deprivation, because they earn their bread by supplying the raw materials for just this junk. I mean, the thing has gotten to the point where there are people in New York and in the big cities that make $50,000, $60,000, $70,000 a year and live like men pursued by their debtors. Are constantly in debt and over their ears in installments and getting ulcers, running like hell to stay in the same place. And they feel very put upon by inflation, because they have to keep up with the Joneses, they have to have all kinds of nonsense and all kinds of foolish expenditures to maintain their place on the ladder of success and keep up face. And people that should be happy and feel like the privileged of the earth lead harried lives, chained to false values, and rushed to an early grave without ever having very much fun. And this is one of the things that the kids in the 60s, in the so-called revolt of the 60s, saw. It was a revolt of affluent youth against unreason. I mean, do we have to run our economy at 105% or 110% of capacity to sop up the unemployment in the marginal elements in the cities? You know, in a war, at least an old-fashioned kind of war, not the war that may be coming, which will be over very quickly, but in a war of attrition like the last war and the First World War, where you needed every bit of labor you could get, it paid, and you could get the money to take blacks and Chicanos and illiterates and crippled people and retarded people and train them and use them, and give them a useful place in society. And we haven't found yet any substitute for war to bring about full employment. Do we have to run the economy on such an overheated basis? Do we, in a world of dwindling resources and rising expectations, have to waste so much metals and energy on this constant drive in which we produce things to wear out fast that normally and sensibly ought to run? Why can't we run an automobile 10 years? Why the hell do we have to change our cars every couple of years? What kind of nonsense? They're built to turn over fast. And everything is built to get obsolete fast. Well, it's really highly irrational. And there ought to be some way to lead more leisurely lives. You know, in the past, leisure and civilization was based on forms of slavery and serfdom. And that's far from having disappeared in covered forms, even in today's world. It was thought that with the coming of the machine, man would be free to enjoy leisure and thought and art without having to do so at the expense of his fellows, without having to turn part of the human race into beasts of burden. But instead, we ourselves have become the slaves of the machine and of the products created by the machine and of artificial needs for artificial products created by the advertising. And isn't it possible to relax a bit and divide the work and provide for the education and the equal opportunity of the peripheral elements of our society? One of the things that makes for a very profound despair is that it's quite easy to talk of revolutionary changes in a society when you have a small number of oppressors and a large number of oppressed. But the world hasn't worked out the way that Marx and Engels figured it would in the middle of the 19th century. The picture that they had was that the concentration of wealth and power would go to such an extent, and the iron law of wages, which didn't work out, thank God, to such an extent that you would have a world in which a very, very few would own everything, and the overwhelming mass of the people would be pushed down to a minimal subsistence level by the iron law of wages and loss of property. Now, it hasn't turned out that way. The fact is that the industrial proletariat is not a majority, much less an overwhelming majority, in any of the advanced countries, and their standard of living is quite good. And so-called revisionists like Bernstein and the welfare state have given the working class in the West, in many ways, a much better standard of living, far more freedom than they enjoy in the communist states. That's one of the realities of the modern world. When the dispossessed and the desperate and the underprivileged are only a small fringe, it's very hard to make a revolution, and it's very hard to push even for any kind of fundamental reform for the benefit of minority marginal elements against the will of a majority, even a majority that in many ways is as thoughtful and kind and charitable as I think the majority of people in our country is. I think they compare very favorably with many countries if you look at it objectively. So this makes for a great difficulty. And you kids are going to have to deal with this world. And you'd better remember that you should be educating yourself not just to get a job, but to be sure there's a society in which to get a job that won't be harrowed by these tremendous problems. You have obligations of citizenship and necessities of survival. And we need a generation of greater sympathy than ever and greater knowledge than ever to deal with the complex problems of our country. And you better do some reading and studying. You better get the hell off of that TV tube. And you better learn how to read and enjoy it. And you better learn that learning is not easy, but hard and joyful at the same time. And that you're privileged And you're privileged above all to be the inheritors of great traditions and a great country and a great a land that is very rich. And you'd better do your part to hand it on to the future in as good a condition as was handed on to you. In addition to this obsolescence at home, we have the obsolescence of the international system. You know that in the 19th century, the forces that led to the establishment of the League of Nations saw that the balance of power was a deceptive metaphor, and that it was like it sounded very nice, the balance of power, very nice and calm and balanced, but it was like standing on a raft in a sea in a hurricane, and it was going to upset quite easily. And they saw the weakness of the nation state and the need to get away from the arms race and war. And this went into the building of the League of Nations. And of course, similar things went into the United Nations. But there were new elements. There were new elements. And what confronts us today is that more and more problems of our society are now beyond the power even of the strongest and the richest national states, and those that are blessed with the greatest expanse of land and of resources, like the USA and the USSR, even they are not great enough, powerful enough, to insulate themselves. The problems of saving our food supplies, of saving the fisheries, of saving the seas from pollution, the problem of providing for orderly marketing of crops and allocation of resources against hunger. There's no reason why, in a world as hungry as this one, there shouldn't be an unlimited market for the farmers of the Middle West at a fair price, financed by international measures. And we have all kinds of new international institutions that reflect the growing awareness of this. We have not only the United Nations, we have the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, the Food and Agriculture Organization. We had a recent meeting on the Mediterranean in which the danger of the pollution of that great sea and the loss of its fishing resources is now so great that even the Arab states and Israel sat down together in the discussions. And this is all to the good. But the movement in this direction is far too slow, and the contrary tendencies are very, very great. What we see, those of us, a whole generation thought that you get rid of the struggle for markets and capitalist imperialism, you'd have peace in the world. What we see today is that Russia and China got rid of capitalism and are enmeshed in a more hateful and dangerous quarrel than ever before. We just got out of Southeast Asia, thank God, and now the Cambodians and the Vietnamese, both enjoying a communist society, are at it in the most bloody and brutal and unbrotherly fashion. The tribalisms and nationalisms of the world are more poisonous and worse than ever. The 30 years war between Catholic and Protestant is being replayed in Ulster. I don't need to touch on the follies of the Arab-Jewish quarrel that tends to bring out the worst on both sides in Palestine and in the Middle East. Africa is balkanized and beset by tribalisms. You know, one thing about mankind that I think is true is that the hardest thing of all is to change people's habits. People like their old habits, even more than their economic interests. The whole Victorian capitalist theory and Marxist theory was based on a really oversimplified view of human interest. But what people will sacrifice their interest to very often are their old shoes. They hate to get rid of them. They're so nice and comfortable. And what we see generally, not only in human history but in biology, is that If the change of conditions requires a change of habits in a species that goes much beyond a fairly small proportion of its activities. If the change in habits called for is very great, that species will die out and will be unable to adjust. And that is the problem that we face in the planet. The idea of nuclear deterrence is as delusive as balance of power. It's a very precarious thing to depend upon. If men hate, they fight and kill, and how much they kill doesn't matter a lot if the hatred builds up enough. And yet in a world without law, no nation state can protect, no nation state can trust the other. Everybody has to work on the worst possible scenario, beloved of the Pentagon. It's as if we had no law and no police in our cities and towns. And everybody had to arm against a possible malevolent neighbor. You can imagine the spiral of suspicion and hatred and distrust, the fear and the need to watch and to pull down your blinds and be sure that you bought the latest model machine gun and had the latest model hand grenade, and how every cause of suspicion would escalate. And that's what's true of the world at large. So there's a paradox going on, a paradoxical movement. On the one hand, the world is becoming very small. When I was a boy, Jules Verne wrote his sensational novel about Round the World in 80 days. Well, pretty soon, certainly by satellite, you can go around the world in 80 minutes. And the world is becoming very small. And to some extent, we are becoming one people. We all share in, we're all to some extent Greeks and Jews and Romans and Englishmen and Frenchmen and Russians. And we're also beginning, since the 19th century, when scholarship opened up the treasures of Oriental thought, we know a little bit about Confucius and the Upanishads and the Buddha and the contribution of the Indians and the Chinese, and that too has become part of a universal a culture. And this offers hope, because it's very hard to have a system of law without a sense of community. And it's hard to have a community without a sense that we're all parts of one another and a sense of identification with each other. And we need that sense of community in the world if we're going to be able to deal with the monster of nuclear war and bring it under control. So that I guess all I'm trying to say is that let's not use our political leaders as easy scapegoats. The problems are very complex, and they do require more thought, more willingness to change, more compassion on the part of all of us. You know, if you know what the Quakers call concern, and if we could raise the level of concern for others by 30, 40, 50%, to give it a fallacious number, an awful lot of problems would disappear. An awful lot of problems would disappear. So let's utilize our freedoms and our good fortune and our freedom to speak and our privilege of being educated to explore these things more fully and to see what we can do about them, because when a majority is ready for wise and compassionate measures, they will be taken. They will be taken, no matter how inadequate the men in the White House may be. They will always respond to a real, overwhelming majority mandate. And I apologize for not having a better message than that. But I can't truthfully trot out any easier answers it's as if all of a sudden so many banal truths take on new meaning. And we really live in a period in which to be banal and platitudinous and obvious and gee whiz, old hat, we're not going to survive without an intensified sense of brotherhood.
Stone would like to have questions from the audience. The gentleman in the red sweater.